Here goes Davis.
Oh, my gosh.
Davis is going to run it all the way
here
back.
Here comes pressure. Bortles sees it coming. Looking for Wharton in the end zone. Wharton behind the defense. Oh!
Are you kidding?
Welcome, everyone, to Blacksburg, Virginia. Welcome to Lane Stadium, and welcome to the annual Virginia Tech spring football game. Alongside former Hokie offensive line great Dwight Vick, I'm Brad Law. Dwight, we know what Bud Foster and company bring defensively, what Scott Leffler, the offensive coordinator, and Frank Beamer, and these 30,000-plus fans want to see today will be how will the quarterbacks fare in their competition to replace record-setting Logan Thomas.
And that's right, Brad. Today is about finding out which quarterback is going to take that first step and seize the position as the starter. We know what Bud Foster's defense can do. Over the 20 last years, he's done a great job in securing great defenses, top 10 ranked defenses. But today we want to see what the offense can do. Logan Thomas is now gone, so a new quarterback must step forward to take this position.
And we'll see three on display today. We'll talk about quarterbacks and much more coming up from Lane Stadium. It's the annual Virginia Tech spring football game. Thank you. Chris, I wasn't sure how long our break was there, and so, okay.
You said the quarterback's alive?
Yeah, I don't think that's right.
Okay. I mean, we'll do what we gotta do. Make it work. Adjustments.
Let's go, baby! Let's go! Let's go! Let's go, baby! Let's go, baby!
You would think that it was a Thursday night home game here in Blacksburg as Enter Sandman blares and 30,000-plus begin to stand and cheer and jump up and down as the white team receives today's opening kickoff. Newsom and Mangus back to receive, and we're underway from Lane Stadium. And for the white team, they'll get things going from the 12, maybe the 13-yard line, and we'll get to see the first of three quarterbacks on display today for the Hokies. Brendan Motley, 6'4", redshirt sophomore out of nearby Christiansburg, Virginia.
Motley's a guy I'm very high on, very mobile quarterback. He's always been a winner no matter where he's played, having a great spring, has not turned the ball over all spring, so that's a good sign for him.
Initially, Frank Beamer made the decision that quarterbacks would be live today. He has since repealed that decision, and quarterbacks will not be live, as you see Motley in the gold jersey. Base defenses most of the time for the Hokies in the first play of this annual Virginia Tech spring game goes for little or no yardage off the left side.
Yeah, they're going to keep it vanilla at first. And don't be surprised, even though the rules are different, don't be surprised to see Bud Foster blitz off the edge. I know they can't blitz but so many times, but Bud Foster steps off the bus blitzing.
Joel Caleb, the first running back on display here this afternoon. Found the going tough off the left side. It'll be second down and 10 to go. Play action for Motley. He's got some open field, and we'll see a little bit of mobility from Brendan Motley as he rushes for very near a first down, 10 yards off to the right side, before Kendall Fuller chased him and ushered him out of bounds across the way. 10-minute quarters for these teams today, and we mentioned base defenses unless the yardage to go is 3 yards or less, and then Dwight Bud Foster can get creative as he likes to do so much.
Absolutely. Bud Foster, I know he sees these rules. They talked about it in the coaches' meeting, but Bud Foster is one of the biggest competitors in the country, and he may send an eight-man blitz off the top.
Motley back under center after the initial first down of the afternoon, and now a little speed from the edge. Breaking into open field, Dimitri Knowles down the left sideline in a big gain. No trick plays today from Virginia Tech and offensive coordinator Scott Leffler. Instead, we just saw the speed of Dimitri Knowles, 53 yards after he found a crease.
And that's a great pickup by Knowles, because last year he started the season off shaky with a bunch of drops. We all know about his speed. It's been well documented, but we need more big plays from him. And that's one of the times that you see what he can do when he gets in the open field.
Knowles, a big weapon on special teams as a kick returner. He flashed the speed there. Little bit of trouble with the snap initially, and now a little trouble in the backfield. Knowles again, they went back to the well, but Kendall Fuller read the play and was able to track him down in the backfield, a loss of a couple.
Great job by the defense staying home on the backside that time. They read that play well.
Kendall Fuller made the stop for the Maroon defense. Second down and 12.
Frank Beamer, the head coach, on the field behind the offense as they huddle before this second and 12 play. It's the opening drive of the afternoon. We talk about Knowles and Josh Stanford, Carlos Parker. We talk new quarterbacks. Whomever the quarterback will be in the fall will have some weapons to work with from the receiver position and maybe from the running back spot as well. As Joel Caleb breaks it up the middle for the first score of the afternoon.
Fantastic opening drive by the offense. Joel Caleb, a great recruit coming out of the Midlothian area. Been waiting for him to turn the light bulb on, and that was a great run by him. Great drive by the offense.
A 27-yard scamper right up the middle after he broke the initial contact off of right guard. He was off to the races.
Well, all this talk about defense, and right now we have an offensive showcase going on right now.
And that's got to make the fans here happy. You want to see a little more production from the offense this season, the second under Scott Leffler as the offensive coordinator. Remington Henshaw kicks the extra point through. It caps a 5-play, 87-yard drive that took 2 minutes and 55 seconds off the clock. And the white team takes the early lead here, Dwight, 7-0. Well, we saw a little bit there on the edge with Dimitri Knowles. We saw Joel Caleb flashing some speed and some toughness up the middle. Good balance on the opening drive.
Very good balance. And what I like about that drive as well is the calls gave the offensive line a chance to sustain blocks. It was simple and vanilla, but yet an opportunity for them to get a hat on the hat and open up some holes. Great run and great call by the offense.
That'll give us an opportunity now to see Mark Leal come onto the field as the quarterback. Leal, a fifth-year senior, was called into action in the second half of the bowl game after Logan Thomas was injured and had a rough go of it. This is sort of a fresh start for him here in spring practice. It's his last go-around with the Hokies.
Yeah, Leal's been around the program a long time. Throws a great ball. That Sun Bowl game for him was tough because Logan Thomas got knocked out. He had to come in the game in the second half, and then unfortunately he had some very bad turnovers. in the spring so far, he's been injured. So the coaches really want to give him a chance to see what he can do. So hopefully he can have a great game today.
The team's a mix of first string guys, returning starters, and reserves. A different format than last year here in Blacksburg, as the maroon team is set to receive. All special teams plays are live as Carlos Parker fields the kick, looks for room, and then is corralled around the 25-yard line.
So far, good coverage by the special teams. Last year, the special teams gave up a lot of big plays. Unfortunately, cost the Hokies some games last year. So even though it's in the spring and two kickoffs early, great coverage by the special teams.
Jeremy Haynes, the man who was there on the stop, the first to get to Parker. And now here's Mark Leal. He's got J.C. Coleman in the backfield with him. And it will be Coleman who gets the snap, and he is brought down after a 5-yard loss. Chase Williams tracked down and taken down at the 20. The coaches really love the way Williams plays the game, a cerebral guy, a lot of football smarts.
Yeah, he's Coach Greg Williams' son, great player. He's had a bit of a tough go early in his career, but so far he's having a fantastic spring. Played that play well on the edge right there. Second and 15.
So the Virginia Tech defense of the white team creating long yardage situations. Parker and Byrne, the receivers. It'll be Byrne that goes in motion from right to left. And now flags fly for the first time this afternoon, and someone moved early.
And even in the spring, Brad, coaches do not like that. I know it's the spring. You expect that. New faces are all over the place, but Coach Beamer, I can tell you, hates penalties, even in the spring.
Charlie Meyer in as a wideout. And just like that, second and 15 becomes second and 20. Leal and company behind the eight ball. Trying to get Meyer out in space. Pick up of just a couple.
Sorry. Meyer's a guy last year that they really had high hopes for. He came in, he's a walk-on receiver, had a great summer, then got injured in late August, right before the Alabama game. But they were really high on him. Hopefully he can stay healthy this season.
So with third down and 17 to go, Byrne and Parker split left. Coleman to the near side. He's the intended target, and he hauls it in around the 25. Picks up good yardage on the play, but Chuck Clark is there to cut him off before he reaches first down yardage, and the maroon team will have to punt it away.
And even though he didn't get that first down, J.C. Coleman is the kind of running back they really want to use in the passing game and get him on the edge. He's great catching the ball. When he gets in open space, he can make big plays.
So A.J. Hughes will punt the ball away. Deion Newsom back to receive. Donovan Riley as well. So the white team with the early advantage, a five-play scoring drive. Followed by a defensive effort that put the maroon team in long yardage early on, and they weren't able to recover. Dwight, obviously, we'll talk about the quarterbacks a lot here throughout the afternoon, but how much can you take from the first drive for each of these guys?
Well, again, it's the spring. I think the coaches are looking at more situations and looking at how they react to the defenses. This is not going to be a spring where you define who your starter is going to be, but more so which quarterback is headed in the right direction.
Punt bobbled and then caught at the 26-yard line by Newsom, a 43-yard punt. It'll be the white team with possession. Their second drive of the afternoon coming up when we return to Lane Stadium. Chris Mangus absolutely tattooed on the first play of the white team's second drive. Sean Heiselkamp was there to meet Mangus and drive him back. It's a loss of four on the play.
Yeah, unfortunately, not good blocking right there by the offensive line, and that's what they don't want to see from the offense, especially the offensive line, albeit going against a great defensive line. You still got to be careful going against penetration like that.
It's one of the storylines that we're watching this spring at Virginia Tech is the offensive line, a revamped group under first-year coach Stacy Searles. Motley being chased, showing some elusiveness, and they'll touch him down back well beyond the line of scrimmage. The quarterback's not live today, and so that counts as a sack. Dwayne Alford gets credit for it. Stacy Searles coming over from Texas to lead this offensive line. They want to add bulk and improve on that 120-yard per game rushing performance. And trying to reload defensively, Dwight. Seven starters gone from last year's team, but around here no one really panics about that. They know they just need to reload on that side of the ball.
Yeah, and Coach Foster, again, he has a track record of reloading. And some of these guys that were not starters played a lot of reps last year, and they're very confident in what they can do. Had a conversation with Bud Foster last Saturday, and he loves his first unit. It feels like his second unit will make great plays when given the opportunity.
Motley looking for Knowles on the right sideline. And it was just a little bit beyond his reach. There's a 10-mile-an-hour wind here today, and it's blowing across the field. You wonder if maybe that played any part, a sideline route. And that'll bring up fourth down and 25. And now the white team will have to kick it away.
Yeah, not too many plays for fourth and 25, Brad, unless you're playing Madden on Xbox.
Davis and Byrne back to return, and it'll be good field position, presumably, for the Maroon team. Hughes standing in his own end zone to kick the ball away. And it will be good field position for the Maroon team. They'll have it inside the 40-yard line. So a little more advantageous situation here for Mark Leal as he comes back onto the field. Just a 25-yard punt.
Not a good punt.
Leal and Motley, we've talked about them, the impact players in this game, Luther Matty and Kendall Fuller, a couple of the defensive standouts. We've already seen Fuller in action
and Matty,
a couple of times today.
And Matty's a great player. I mean, the moment he came on campus, he's been making plays. Undersized D-tackle from Florida, but he's been wreaking havoc since he got to Virginia Tech. I think he could be the best defensive tackle in ACC.
And for the second time today, there's early movement on that offensive line of the Maroon team. Braxton Pfaff, a freshman out of Lynchburg, Virginia, moved early. Marshawn Williams is in at tailback. A lot of excitement over this early enrollee. And he won't get the touch this time. Is breaking into open field goes Carlos Parker. One man had a shot to get him, and that's the man who brought him down at the 16-yard line.
Great run by Parker. Another guy that last year didn't get a lot of reps until late in the season. Fast receiver, again, playing with more confidence this spring. They're hopeful that he can make more plays this spring.
26-yard pickup. Daddy Nicholas chased him down from that defensive line, ran him down at the 16. Williams again, the lone setback, as Leal calls out the changes to the offensive line. And here is Williams. A stutter step, a clogged line, and he continues to fight forward. He'll pick up two very hard-fought yards off the right side of that offensive line.
Well, no contact's not a problem for him. Williams is a very, very tough runner. It's hard to believe. Actually, he still should be in high school right now. He enrolled early from Hampton, Virginia, played 3 years at my alma mater, Hampton High School, and then transferred to Phoebus and continued where he left off when he got to Phoebus. When I was down here last week and I talked to the coaches, and everybody raved about what a physical specimen he is at the running back position.
And he's added 13 pounds since reporting 3 months ago. He'll get the call again. This time, just a yard.
And the way he runs, you can see why the coaches are high on him, because in the running back mix, he's going to figure to be the guy to get those tough yards for a short third and goal or second and one. He's the kind of running back that's going to move the chains.
The freshman met by the fifth-year senior, Dietrich Bonner, right in the middle of the line. That'll bring down third down and eight to go. The maroon team in the red zone for the first time this afternoon. And we'll see what they dial up with 8 yards to go. Leal looking left, firing left, and a tough catch made by Parker coming over the middle. The ball was a little bit high and a touch behind him, but Parker showed his good hands, snagged it, brought it down.
One thing I like about that play is Leal did not turn the ball over. And even though they didn't get the touchdown, you'll take the field goal attempt versus a turnover.
Eric Christensen is on to attempt the field goal. Leal will hold. This is a 28-yard attempt.
Good kick.
And it's good. So the maroon team is on the board as the first quarter comes to a close. 10 minutes of football in the books in Blacksburg. The white team on top, 7-3. We're back with the second quarter. And we'll get to see the white team on the field again. So a nice answer by the maroon team. They had the early penalty, got the big play from Parker. And we've seen now on both sides, both Parker and Knowles, speed on the edge, able to find some open running room and turn that into big plays.
Well, when I had a chance to talk to Coach Moorhead, the wide receiver coach, last weekend, one thing he emphasized to me is that he's going to play his guys that have the confidence and speed. This year, Virginia Tech enters the season with a lot of talent at the wide receiver position. Very deep at that position. So, great drive by the offense. So far, this spring game has been much better than last year.
Virginia Tech's 2013 season saw the Hokies go 5-3 in league play, all three conference losses by a touchdown or less. So the conventional wisdom is that if they can get anywhere between a field goal to a touchdown, more production from the offensive side of the ball this year, particularly in the Coastal Division of the ACC, it's wide open and there for the taking for the Hokies this year.
It is wide open. And last year, I think sometimes we forget that they had a chance to win the Coastal Division all the way up to the last week of the season when they were playing UVA. And if you look at the Coastal Division, we'll take a look at that later, but every team either lost their starting quarterback or an offensive coordinator. So every team in the division is probably thinking, why not us, including Virginia Tech.
First quarter numbers. Mark Leal, 3 for 3 through the air, 19 yards. Motley missed on his only pass attempt in the first quarter of play. And we'll review some of the other numbers. We'll have much more from Blacksburg and Lane Stadium. It's the annual Virginia Tech spring football game.
Check one.
Okay.
Brad, can you hear me?
I got you. Yep.
Okay. Thank you. Appreciate it. Sorry.
Number 30, Mitchell Runaway, kicking off the first team. Deep to the white team, number 20,
the white team will open the second quarter with the ball at the 28-yard line as Deion Newsom ran it out to there. We mentioned that Leal was 3 for 3 in the first quarter. Now Brendan Motley back out onto the field. He is one of 5 quarterbacks who will be in the midst of the race to replace the record-setting Logan Thomas. 40 consecutive starts at quarterback. I think in all he held 11 school records here, Dwight, 4 single-season records.
And that's tough to replace, not so much all the other stats, but the 40 consecutive starts, because what that equals is experience. And the remaining quarterbacks on this roster don't have that kind of experience.
Motley backpedaling but finding Bucky Hodges, the versatile tight end. Motley retreating and throwing off of his back foot found Hodges for 8 yards over the middle. And you really like the game of Bucky Hodges.
I sure do. Bucky right now to me is the best kept secret in the ACC. I talked to Coach Donspring and he informed me last weekend that once the light bulb goes off of Bucky, he will be one of the biggest and best playmakers in the country. He's just that kind of player. Very athletic. A 6'6 tight end with that kind of speed can be dangerous for a defense.
Newsom and Knowles split out to the left on second down and 2. And there's just not much there. The defensive line doing a nice job over the left side of the line as Daniel Dyer got the carry and went backwards. He lost a couple. Nigel Williams, the first man there to bring him down.
Great play by Nigel Williams. He's a guy that, again, that I talked about earlier, that's coming in to start but played a lot of reps last year. Very physical. I like his game. Made some plays last year, particularly last year against Marshall in the goal line. Had a big stop that forced a field goal attempt.
So to bring down or bring up third down and 4 yards to go. On an absolutely gorgeous day. Again, Knowles and Newsom, the receivers. And flags fly. So this time it's the white team who's guilty of an infraction and will move back. False start. The third one of those on the day, and as you said, it's all the same team, whether it's the maroon team or the white team. It's the offensive line, and new coach Stacy Searles won't be happy about that.
No, he won't, and that's what I referred to earlier. Even though it's a spring game, this is an evaluation time. And if you're trying to earn a starting job, no matter if you're in high school or in college, you can't have a false start. I know that sounds tough and demanding, but when you're trying to win a position or show the coaches that they can trust you, you can't false start.
Four wides, third and 4 becomes 3rd and 9. And Motley will go to the air, looking over the middle. It's going to be short of the first down. He finds Hodges again. He picked up 5 on the play. And that shows the effect of the penalty, 3rd down and 9. If it's 3rd and 4, a 5-yard gain picks up the first down, but now they'll have to punt it away again.
But again, great play by the quarterback by not turning the ball over. Even though he didn't get the first down, he didn't force the issue right there.
Byrne and Travis back. after a kick that sails out of bounds. And the Maroon team will have pretty good starting field position again. They'll spot it right at the 40-yard line. It's a kick of 25 yards. And it'll be Mark Leal and company back on the field when we return to the Virginia Tech spring game. The white team on top, 7-3 here in Blacksburg. Temperature in the low 70s today. Chance of rain, zero. Completely non-existent. It makes for a terrific day. And the crowd has turned out accordingly.
Yeah, great-looking crowd. And, you know, it's great to have a nice day in Blacksburg. Sometimes in Blacksburg, you may have 70-degree weather and come out of class, and it may be snowing 6 inches.
Here's number six, Mark Leal. In the shotgun to start this drive from the 40-yard line. He's a perfect 3-for-3 thus far, and he's going for broke down the left sideline just beyond the reach of Willie Byrne. A nice-looking pass, but he led Byrne by just 3 to 4 inches too far.
Great throw, though. I like the fact that he's looking downfield, something that you need to do to stretch the defense. And also to one of my favorite players, Willie Byrne. Met this guy in high school, walked on to Virginia Tech, earned a scholarship last year. He was the guy that came on strong when they needed someone to step up at the receiver position last season.
And on second look, Donovan Riley was there in the coverage and was going step for step with him as Jerome Wright is in to the left of Leal. Picks up his blocking assignment on a pass for 5 yards to the left side to Darius Redmond. Redmond, 6'4", 270-plus, fourth-year junior out of the D.C. area. And without Calvin Klein and Ryan Malik competing today here in the spring game, we get a chance to see a couple of the other tight ends in action. Redmond, and we already saw Bucky Hodges haul in a couple of passes.
And the tight end position is loaded. According to Coach Steinspring, they got Klein, who was a freshman last year. They also have Bucky and also Malik, who's coming off an injury. So they have some depth at the tight end position.
On third down and five, flags are down. There's going to be a holding penalty on the play. Leal was running toward daylight, but the Maroon team will be moving backwards. And Ken Ikanem was in pursuit. He's a guy that the coaches are really excited about. Ikanem has a world of potential, suffered a devastating knee injury in the state championship game his senior year in high school, played a little bit last year, but as some of those senior defensive linemen have moved on, they're really excited about seeing Ken Ikanem move into place.
And they should like him. He's a big-time player. People forgot about him. He had the red shirt last year due to that injury, but is having a monster spring. I saw him play in high school. He did get injured against Phoebus in the state championship game, but since getting his chance to shine this spring, he's wreaked havoc on the offensive line. Very physical, very athletic.
We mentioned the quarterback battle, and we'll talk more. I mean, we talked about Leal and Motley and what they've done thus far.
Great kick.
A tremendous kick is going to chase Newsom all the way back to the goal line and into the end zone. It'll be a touchback, a 55-yard punt. And we look up at the American flag high atop Lane Stadium, and it's blowing the other way. That's a 55-yard punt into the wind, and Newsom was scrambling. We'll talk more about the quarterback battle when we return. Three guys on campus and two that aren't here yet that will certainly be a part of the discussion in the summer and the fall. We have much more to come from Lane Stadium. The white team leads the maroon team 7-3. Motley in the shotgun. This drive begins at the 20-yard line. The white team leading the maroon team 7-3 as we approach the midway point of the second quarter. Joel Caleb takes the carry up the middle and finds tough sledding. A couple of yards on the play for Caleb. Sean Heiselkamp again in on the stop. Motley directing the white team. We've yet to see true freshman Andrew Ford today. We expect to see him a little bit later on in the spring game. And then there are a couple of guys, Dwight, who aren't on campus yet. Texas Tech transfer Michael Brewer graduates next month, is expected to be on campus shortly thereafter. And then another true freshman, Chris Durkin, to arrive in August, a 6'3", 240-pound-plus prospect. Pass is tipped into the air, and that's dangerous territory around these parts when you give the secondary a chance to react. It'll bring up third down and 8. Heiselkamp was the guy who's having a big afternoon. He got the hand on it, tipped it into the air. 5 tackles for Heiselkamp already today.
That's great. You know, Chris Durkin is the type of quarterback. You talk about the quarterbacks, he's very physical. You look at his stats as well as his physical size. He figures to be in the mix when he gets here too, as well as Brewer, who's transferring from a very pass-happy offense. So it'll be interesting to see what happens in August.
4 receivers on third down and 8. Good protection. And a catchable ball over the middle, in and out of the hands of Motley's intended target, Deion Newsom. The redshirt freshman got his hands on it but couldn't haul it in, and the white team will be forced to kick it away again.
And that's a tough catch by him. He should have made that, but he's having a great spring. I played football here with his father. Deion is a playmaker, having a great spring. Wouldn't be surprised to see him get a lot of action on kick returns this year.
Hughes puts the leg into it. The wind has shifted, and so the kick goes into the wind. And falling down is Byrne at the 42-yard line. 41-yard kick, 4 yards on the return. And the maroon team will have it back when we return to Lane Stadium. 4:45 to go in the first half, and the white team leads the maroon team 7-3 in Blacksburg. from the 42-yard line. It's J.C. Coleman who takes the handoff. And once again, he is met in the backfield. He'll lose 3, maybe 4 yards on the play. Luther Maddie clogging the middle of the line and forcing the Maroon team into another long yardage situation on second down.
Again, you see why they're very high on Luther Maddie, an experienced defensive tackle. Plays a true freshman, very difficult to block because he plays with great leverage and he's very quick off the ball.
Not much going in the ground game thus far. The always stingy defense has been able to put a bottle on that as Leal will go to the air. Pass is tipped into the air and caught across the 45-yard line. Charlie Meyer, a heads-up play, was able to get his hands on the ball. Carlos Parker was the intended target. It ricocheted off of his hands. Meyer in the right place at the right time. It bounced off of a couple of guys before Meyer hauled it in and had the presence of mind to fall forward to the 46.
Sometimes it's just better to be lucky than good. That's a great, great heads-up play by him and way to keep the chains moving.
Third down and 6 to go for the Maroon team. Combined, the Maroon and White squads are 0 for 4 on third down conversions. Leal to the air. To the right side, this will be close. Coleman hauls it in over on the right side. Maybe just about a half yard shy of the first down. Zakeel Muhammad was there on the tackle. And on fourth down and about a half a yard to go, decision time in the spring game.
Yeah, it's nothing like a fourth and short in the spring game. Albeit, you know, it's the spring, you still evaluate and see how the offensive line handles the situation, as well as a play call by the offensive coordinator. Let's see what they do.
They're going to go for it here. They need a half yard to go, testing the offensive line, and there's a breakaway carry. J.C. Coleman broke the initial contact off right tackle and then churned forward for the first down.
Great run by J.C. right there, and great push by the offensive line. Little slip up with the handoff, but they still got the first.
One man had a shot in the backfield. Coleman kept plowing forward. Williams was there to bring him down, but not before a 9-yard gain and a first down. Talk about the running game, and so far today, the biggest gains have come from a pair of wide receivers, and we'll talk more about that when we return to Blacksburg. 7-3, the white team on top in the Virginia Tech spring football game. Maroon team with a first down at the white team's 41-yard line as we get set to resume play here at Virginia Tech. 2:23 to go in the first half. The Maroon team with 64 yards of total offense thus far. A 26-yard run by Carlos Parker, the biggest chunk of that. 86 yards of total offense for the white team. Dimitri Knowles' 52-yard run, a big part of that. And here's another long throw from Leal on first down. Down the right side, it is Willie Byrne who brings it down at the 2-yard line. A 39-yard pitch and catch. A beautiful throw and a textbook catch on the play by Byrne. And now the Maroon team is set up first and goal.
Fantastic throw and catch. Now you see why Last season, Willie Byrne was nicknamed the Paperboy by the coaches and his teammates because they felt that he was always open and delivered. And that was a great one-handed play. May make sports in his top 10.
J.C. Coleman is the tailback. Will he get the call on first and goal? Yes, he will. And there's not much there. He's going to be wrapped up and collared back at the four-yard line. Take a look at the pass and catch again. Plenty of air under it. And then a one-handed catch over the shoulder.
And last year, Willie Byrne was so clutch. He made great plays. He made the tying touchdown against Maryland, sending the game into overtime. Again, one of these players that comes to Blacksburg as an unknown and leaves a superstar. They just do a great job of developing talent here, and I'm really happy for Willie Byrne.
Pair of tight ends in the game now as Coleman again gets the carry, tries to cut it off the left side, is able to shake one man but not the second. Dietrich Bonner kept Coleman from getting to the edge completely and finding pay dirt. And what was first and goal at the two is now third down and goal from the three-yard line.
Bonner did a good job right there playing the edge, not giving him the pylon to get to. Great job of Bonner, a veteran DB. Torian Gray loves his instinct and loves his intelligence. He really trusts him to call the defensive plays throughout the season.
So after the 39-yard pitch and catch, they've gone with running plays on first and second down from inside the five. See if they go to the arm of Leal. Got a heavy formation again in. Redman and Willenbrock are the tight ends. Play fake, and they'll go to the right side to Griffin Height, a fullback, and he stopped short. Dietrich Bonner again on the stop.
And what you're seeing right now is why Bud Foss is considered by many to be the best defensive coordinator in the country. Big play by Byrne, but right now in the red zone, the defense is saying you're not ready to get in here.
One of the staples of these Frank Beamer teams are stingy defense, solid and spectacular special teams play. You're talking about the winningest active coach in the in FBS football right now, and you're talking about the longest tenured coach as well since 1987 at Virginia Tech. Conference championships, Coach of the Year awards, both league and nationally.
Just a fantastic coach. I love playing for him. Invited me to come here along with other guys to help build this program. His vision has come true, and he's still hungry, still passionate about trying to bring a championship to this program. Really believes into his players, believes in his coaches, empowers his coaches to take lead of their positions, and he really wants to see them all do well.
So often transitioning to a new conference is difficult, but the Hokies won 10 or more games in their first 8 years in the ACC. And on fourth down, they'll just lob it up into the end zone, and it is juggled and incomplete over on the far side. They were looking for Parker. And good coverage by Chuck Clark on the play. The free safety came over and made sure that Parker was not able to haul it in. So the gamble on fourth down does not pay off offensively. You look at it as a good test for the defense with their backs against the wall, facing a first and goal defensively, and they're able to hold the other side out of the end zone.
And absolutely. And Bud Foster, what fans may not realize, when they got to the red zone, he does not panic. He looks at red zone defense as an opportunity to see what kind of defense they're going to run, as well as how his players will handle adversity. He was really excited about that. You see why they made a great stop. Great play by Chuck Clark.
One play likely remains in the first half. 7 seconds on the clock. The white team scored on a five-play drive on their first possession of the afternoon. And Motley's going to air it out, go for broke, and why not? And it is going to be picked off by Kendall Fuller. Kendall Fuller waited on it to fall, watched it into his arms, and why not? He had six a year ago. Why not come down with a pick in the spring game?
Leaving where he left off last year, great play by him. was arguably the best DB in the ACC last year and only a freshman. He's only going to get better. Look for him to have a great season this year.
So a couple of big plays from wide receivers in the running game in the first half. First quarter scoring, all there was. No points in the second period of play. And after one half at Lane Stadium, the white team leads the maroon squad 7-3. It's halftime, and we have more halftime coverage for you from Blacksburg when we return. outstanding player of spring practice thus far. Dwight, we've yet to call Josh's name here in this game, but he's certainly shown the coaches what he can do in the three scrimmages and the practices around those scrimmages here in the spring.
Yeah, Stanford's a guy they like a lot. Last year, he had a case of the drops early in the season, and then towards midseason and the rest of the season, he had a great job catching the ball and making plays after the catch. One game in particular that stands out is the Miami game when he took a simple out route to the house, and he made a great play in that game, and he's had a fantastic spring. Very athletic receiver, and I think he can make big plays for the Hokies this season.
You're looking for big plays offensively, and you look at that wide receiver core between Stanford and Knowles and Parker and Byrne and Hodges at the tight end spot, not to mention the guys who aren't out there on the field today. And it looks like the quarterback, as we touched on earlier in the telecast, will have plenty of options offensively. Just got to get the ball to him.
Well, the key for the offense this year, and just like the last several years, is the offensive line. It's important that they protect and also hold up, because they're going to have playmakers at the receiver position as well as the tight end position. And as we showed earlier, we have a plethora of running backs. So it's going to be very interesting to see what they decide to do, because they will have the weapons to make plays if the offensive line comes together, which I think eventually they will.
The white team, 9 rushes, 72 yards in the first half. The maroon squad, 9 rushes for 27 yards. And as we touched on earlier, big chunks of the running game are coming from the wide receivers. Parker with a 26-yard carry and Knowles with 52. Those are just some of the stats from the first half. We're about 5 minutes and change away from the second half of the annual Virginia Tech spring game. We'll have more halftime coverage straight ahead. Second half set to get underway. 7-3, the white team leading the maroon squad in Blacksburg. Thanks for making us a part of your day. It will be the maroon team to receive here in the second half. Carlos Parker, one of two, back to return. Darian Green joins him. They stand back near the 2-yard line. And it will not matter as the kick with the wind sails all the way to the back of the end zone. So the maroon squad will start from the 25-yard line, trailing 7-3. The maroon squad with 102 yards of total offense in the first half. Mark Leal back onto the field to lead the maroon squad. Look at the 2014 slate for the Hokies. William and Mary comes here to Lane Stadium on August 30th, and then a big road test outside the conference at Ohio State.
Well, when you look at the schedule, when you look at the games they have, it sets up nicely for them. William and Mary will be an opponent that they should beat, but again, in college football, this is nothing you can guarantee because anybody can be beat. The Ohio State game sets up nicely for them. Ohio State is a team that has a great quarterback in Miller. But Virginia Tech has a good defense. That'll be a tough game, night game in Columbus. And then after that, you look at the schedule. You have 3 games at home, And then you look later, you have a game, a Thursday night game against Miami, which is essentially a rival game in Lane Stadium. I know that game will be rocking. And then they end the season with their arch rival UVA on Black Friday. So I think if you look at the schedule, it sets up nicely for them.
Back-to-back carries for Marshawn Williams to start the drive. After a 5-yard pickup on first down, he gets one more, and it'll bring up third down and four to go. The home date against the FCS opponent, then a challenging road game outside the league before another non-conference game at home, and then conference play began. That's good rhythm, I think, for a team that's going to be breaking in a new quarterback with some experience at other positions.
Yeah, well, you know, when you look at the schedule, it's fun to look at in the spring. You know, it's April. We all think we know what's going to happen. But unfortunately, in college football, there'll be injuries, there'll be transfers, and there'll also be situations that you can't account for. So what'll be key for Virginia Tech is to make sure they have leaders. I think the last few years, some of their struggles has become because of lack of leadership and lack of playmakers. But this year, they have a lot of playmakers, and I think the schedule sets up nicely for them. Like I said previously, in the Coastal Division, I feel like every team probably feels like they have a chance to win it because each team has an uncertain uncertainty at some position.
Marshawn Williams was the workhorse on that drive. He picked up two more, but not enough for the first down. And so the Maroon team will punt it away. Riley and Newsom back to receive. There's a fair catch called for and taken by Newsom at the 30-yard line. A 37-yard kick. And the white team will take over for its first possession of the second half when we return. 2 minutes into the third quarter at Lane Stadium, the Virginia Tech spring football game, and the white team leading the maroon team 7-3. Andrew Ford's first snap of the afternoon goes to Chris Mangus. And Mangus is able to break free and scurry out for a 7-yard gain. Mangus, a redshirt sophomore out of Raleigh, North Carolina. Ford, the freshman from Camp Hill, Pennsylvania, 6'3", 195. Been a little up and down thus far during the spring scrimmages. Struggled his first time out, as might be expected from a freshman his first time. And then 2 weeks ago, 12 of 15 for 150 yards and a score. In the Hokies' second spring scrimmage, he'll hand off to Mangus, who breaks free again and across the 40 for a first down. And the white team is on the move, leading 7-3.
Ford, a guy who came in early, like Marshawn, and he's had a up and down spring, as you referred to, but they like his arm, the fact that he's accurate when given time, and he just needs to get a little bit thicker. He probably needs to go to redshirt, get stronger. But I like his poise. I like his confidence. He just needs to get a little bit more alert to the college game.
Ford, ranked the number 27 overall player in Pennsylvania by ESPN Recruiting Nation, bobbled the snap. And we've got a pileup at the 40-yard line. And the Maroon team comes out of there with the ball. Deion Clark, the linebacker, came up with a loose ball, a bad exchange on the snap, and the Maroon team comes away with it on the right side of the 50.
Very difficult for Ford in the center. It's difficult because you really want to see what he can do, and you really don't like turnovers. I know Coach Beamer and his staff, even though it's the spring again, like I said earlier, just can't have turnovers because it takes away from the evaluation time you have of all the people playing out there.
So Leal in the shotgun, and Marshawn Williams is with him, the freshman. Releases as Leal throws it wide of his intended receiver inside the 20-yard line. He was looking for Meyer and led him a little too far. Dietrich Bonner in coverage. Bonner with three tackles on the afternoon here. And it brings up second and 10. 6 minutes, 40 seconds to go in the third period.
One thing I like about this spring game so far is that the O-line are protecting pretty much better than what I saw last week and then throughout the spring. So that bodes well.
Leal was 8 for 10 in the first half. And here's Williams on the carry, looking for room off the right side, and he's going to be stacked up, driven back after a 1, maybe 2 yard gain. Josh Eberle, the linebacker, comes up and forces him out of bounds across the far side.
Marshawn just runs so hard, and it may not look attractive, it's not fun, but I can guarantee you those yards he gets are critical, especially when it's going to be in short yardage. I just really love the way he runs. Runs with a sense of urgency, just very, very tough to bring down.
Third down and 8 to go. The Maroon team 0-for-6 on third downs thus far this afternoon. Leal to throw over the middle, and he sends a rocket past his intended target. Darius Redmond, the tight end. And so after the turnover, the Maroon offense not able to move the chains, and the white team will get it back after another punt. A.J. Hughes is back to kick it away. And again, it'll be Newsom and Riley to return. And we'll see if it's Andrew Ford who comes out again and tries to complete his first drive of the afternoon. The punt stops at the 2 yard line.
Great job.
Like a lofty wedge that just dies in the grass. A 35-yard kick, but Hughes wasn't aiming for distance there. He was aiming for location, and he got it at the 2-yard line. That's where the white team will resume possession when we return to Blacksburg. 7-3, the white team on top of the Maroon squad. 5:43 to go in the third quarter. Virginia Tech spring football game. Daniel Dyer carries for an inch, maybe two, before Corey Marshall is there to put a stop to it. And it'll be second and 10 for the white team, leading 7-3 as we approach the midpoint of the third quarter.
Corey Marshall, a guy that left the team last year for personal reasons, set out, but he's returned to join the team and having a great spring. I saw him last week wreak havoc on the offensive line. He's playing very well. He could be a key piece for this defense this season.
At 6'1", 257, he can play outside a little bit and certainly can play inside as he did there. Second down and 10, Motley under center. And he delivers a pass high for Bucky Hodges, but he goes up and hauls it in near the first down marker. And he will pick up the first down, a gain of 10 on the play, and they'll move the chains out from the shadows of the goalposts.
Tough to defend, 6'6". Very difficult. Bucky's going to be a great player for the Hokies.
So Motley goes to the air. Maybe that gives him a little bit of confidence as well. We've seen him a couple of times today, Dwight, under pressure, backpedaling, and on both times he found Hodges on the first down catch. From the 14, this time a quick strike to the left side and a broken tackle by Dimitri Knowles. And he's out across the 20-yard line, a pickup of 6.
I like the call right there. When you have a quarterback who's still trying to gain experience, quick outs, quick throws are good for them to gain confidence, as well as safe throws so they don't turn the ball over.
Seth Dooley, the redshirt freshman, finally hauled Knowles in. And when you pick up 6 to 7 yards on first down, it opens up the playbook a bit. On second down, 3 receivers. Motley calls for the ball, delayed snap count, and now wants to air it out right side. Terrific catch over on the left side, or on the right side, by Newsom. Great. And a perfectly placed ball by Motley. Plenty of air under it, and allowed Newsom to run underneath and make the catch.
Great play by Newsom. Great throw as well. Newsom is a guy that, again, I feel like is going to have a breakout season. It's tough because they have so many receivers, but he brings something to the table that I think no other receiver has, and that's athleticism, especially after the catch.
A 37-yard pick, and the white team is across the 50. Motley to air it out again. Right side. And this time it's a little too far as the intended receiver pulled up. He was looking for Stanford. And you hope that's not something that's going to bother him longer. He pulled up holding the hamstring. Well, we talked earlier about this Virginia Tech defense, and they don't really worry about replacing 7 starters, Dwight, because of the way they recruit, the defensive philosophy. Guys are going to be there. It's just a matter of now who's going to fill in the positions left behind by those 7 starters from a year ago.
When you look at that list, I mean, what a fantastic group of players that really sold it out for Virginia Tech. They played every game like it was their last. But at the same time, Tariq Edwards, you know, he came back last year, had a great season after being injured the season before, as well as Exum. But if you look at Exum and Fuller, these are both guys that the second half of the season didn't play that much. So when you look at the guys that came in, Faison and the younger Fuller, they filled in very well. And I think if you look at Jack Tyler as well as Tariq Edwards, those are two guys that when they came on, they were new too. And when they got their chance, they did very well. So I think the defense will be fine.
We don't have the chance to see Faison today. He's out of the game with the injury. And on a first down and 5 play, streaking off to the left side and picking up big yardage is Deion Newsom. So he's been a spark offensively, once on a catch and once on a carry, an 18-yard tote. And it's inside the 20-yard line. The white team inside the red zone trying to build on a 7-3 lead.
Great run by Newsom. He reminds me a lot of Eddie Royal. I know that's high praise given what Eddie Royal did for this program and what he's doing now in the NFL. But if you look at Newsom, when he gets his hand on the ball, he just has a knack for making plays and making guys miss. And when he sees that end zone, he's likely going to get there.
7th play of the drive coming up. Motley plants. And flags fly as Motley takes off, finds open space into the end zone. But we'll check the flag.
Now, even though that may be holding, what you saw right there by Motley is why the coaches like him a lot. That mobility is critical. And I've said this before, and I'll say it again. Virginia Tech, other than Jim Junkermiller and a few other quarterbacks, has always done well with mobile quarterbacks. And Motley is a mobile quarterback and what they call now a dual threat.
At 6'4", 220, you saw it's not easy to bring him down. He's good flexibility, can bend his body well, and good balance. Unfortunately for the white team, unfortunately for him, all that work goes for naught. And the holding call will bring it back to the 29-yard line. It'll be 1st and 20 from there.
Sure.
Again, Josh Stanford pulled up, holding his right hamstring on a long route earlier in this drive. The offensive MVP of spring drills thus far. Something we'll keep an eye on. As Motley directs traffic from the shotgun. We go under 2.5 minutes to play in the third quarter. Short route, good closing speed as Knowles hauled it in over on the left side. Knowles with just a couple on the play before Darian Green brought him down. You talk about those linebackers that are competing now to replace Jack Tyler and Tariq Edwards, and you see their production. Both guys started every game a season ago, and there's open competition there in the linebacking core.
Well, Bud Foster, he likes his new guys, and they had a chance to watch these two guys, Tyler and Edwards. And the thing about both these guys, especially Tyler, he came to Virginia Tech as a walk-on from Oakland, Virginia, and became one of the best linebackers in the ACC the last 3 years. So Bud Foster knows how to replace talent, and he's got some people that he likes a lot. Deion Clark is having a great spring, so it'll be very interesting to see what they replace. Again, it's tough to replace experience, but you can't get experience until you get an opportunity on the field.
Three starters being replaced from the defensive line, and if guys can clog the middle and wreak havoc like Corey Marshall did on that play, then it'll make it easier for the guys in the linebacking spots to come in, fill gaps, make the right fits, and create losses, as was the case on that play, as Motley was dropped for a 5-yard loss. Third down and 21 for the white team. The safeties will creep up. Couple of flyer outs, and a man breaks open, but the pass from Motley a little too far out in front of Bucky Hodges. The defender fell down on the play, but it was beyond the reach of the big tight end by about 4 yards.
It's a tough call, a tough pass, but what you see right there is what we referred to earlier about Bucky. You got to think later in the season, come October, that play will be there. That's a play that's more about timing. This is the spring. These guys haven't played together for several weeks, so when the season starts, I think Bucky makes that play.
Michael Branover is on to attempt a 48-yard field goal from straight away. With the wind at his back, the kick on the way, and it is no good, wide to the right. So with 42 seconds to go in the third quarter, the white team maintains a 7-3 lead, and the maroon team will get it back. Well, running backs that we've seen today, we've seen J.C. Coleman, we've seen Joel Caleb, we've seen Chris Mangus and Marshawn Williams. We are not seeing today Trey Edmonds, who broke his left tibia in the final regular season game a season ago against Virginia, and he certainly is a productive tailback and one they'll be excited to get back into the rotation here at Virginia Tech.
Well, I thought he played extremely well for a guy, you know, playing as a freshman at the tailback position, and you look at that game against Alabama and what he did against arguably one of the best defenses in the country, and then as the season progressed, he has a nose for the end zone. He runs very hard, and with the running backs they have, and when you get him back, they should have a lot of options at the tailback position.
It's Coleman who gets the carry on first down here. Not much doing there as Chuck Clark is in on his third stop of the day. Andrew Ford back in under center. The second snap of his afternoon was fumbled, and that led to a turnover for the maroon team. He's back in there now on second down and 11. Coleman lost a yard on the first carry. Ford gets the play from the sideline and then delivers it to the huddle. This will likely be the final play of the third period. The clock under 5 seconds if they get it off in time, and they do. And it's play action for the freshman who finds Parker in traffic across to the 36-yard line. So a 6-yard pickup will leave the maroon team 5 yards shy of a first down. And their third down and 5 opportunity will come up when we return. Three quarters in the books, and our score remains 7-3. The white team leading the maroon squad. All the scoring in the first quarter of this one. The fourth quarter is coming up next. Fourth quarter is set to begin here from Blacksburg. The white team leads the maroon team 7-3. 10 minutes to go, and the freshman Andrew Ford leading his team back onto the field. Third down and 5 to go from the 36-yard line. The shotgun snap for Ford. He's got a lot of time. He looks short and finds Michael Brainerd at the 40-yard line. It's a 4-yard gain. Ford with a safe completion over the middle. It will leave the maroon team 1 yard shy of the first down.
And what you saw right there is what I referred to with Ford. I like him a lot. The coaches are high on him. He can definitely read the defenses. It's just with the collegiate level coming from high school, even as an early enrollment, he's going to learn that you have to get rid of the ball a lot quicker, especially in live action against another opponent.
And on fourth down and a yard to go, they'll see what the maroon offense can do here. They'll go for it. 1 for 2 on fourth downs thus far. It's going to be Coleman who surges ahead straight up the middle. He puts his head down, keeps his legs churning, and picks up 3. He needed 1. It's a first down for the maroon team.
I think J.C. Coleman today has run really hard. I mean, you look at his size. He reminds me of a guy by the name of Andre Kendrick, a guy I played with, wore the same jersey. They both run physical, and J.C., despite his short size, plays really physical.
Marshawn Williams, the freshman, back in. The fullback is Griffin Height. A little power running perhaps here on first down from the 43. No, it's play action and complete across the way to Michael Brainerd.
Good throw by Ford right there. That was a good throw.
Gets it out to midfield. Second down, 3 to go. Maybe the white team defense thinking with the power set, the fullback and Williams, that the run play was coming. But success on first down throwing the ball. Ford now 3 for 3 through the air. Williams, the lone setback, will get the carry and then get punished as he's taken down just across midfield by Wade Hansen. Zach Snell also in on the stop.
Torian Gray.
It'll bring up third down and 2 to go. Well, you like Williams' toughness there, but it's just so difficult against the middle of that defense. The maroon team has not converted on 8 previous third down tries. They need 2 at midfield. And they won't get it. It'll be 0-for-9 on third down as Chase Williams comes in and stops J.C. Coleman before he can get a head of steam built up. It's a loss of about a half yard. Back to straightaway midfield.
Great play by Chase Williams getting penetration right there. He's having a great spring and a great, great game today. He has a knack for getting in that gap. And Bud Foster, that's what he wants to look at. He wants to make sure that his linebackers, when it's time to penetrate, they make the play, specifically behind the line of scrimmage. Virginia Tech's defense is about gap control and making sure the offense get out of rhythm, getting them behind the chains, forcing them in long-distance situations.
Shotgun for Ford on fourth down. 3 receivers to the left, and that's where Ford rolls, getting pressured, and now just has to lob it up and over the head of everybody. Wade Hansen was giving chase again, and it'll be a turnover on downs. The white team will take it back, leading 7-3 with 6.5 minutes to go. Ford rolled to his left, the side of his 3 receivers, but you saw the pressure was just too much.
And Ford's strength is not mobility.
The first 8 years in the ACC, the Hokies won double-digit games. But back-to-back 7-8 win seasons. And the Hokies are trying to get back in that double-digit win column. And Dwight, what we talked about, we think is a wide-open Coastal Division this year. I mean, the team 8-5, 5-3 in league play a season ago. All 3 of those losses by a touchdown or less. And in the Coastal Division, no team has both its offensive coordinator and starting quarterback back from a season ago. So very competitive league.
And that's what they want, the fans as well as the coaching staff. They want to get back to winning 10 wins as well as playing for ACC championships. But what it's going to take is playmakers at the quarterback position as well as leadership within the team. I think last year what you saw is a defense that won a lot of games for this Virginia Tech team, but in tough games, there were too many turnovers, not just by Logan, but by the entire offense. They have to be able to make plays in tough ball games if they want to win the Coastal Division.
We saw there with Brendan Motley back in at quarterback the zone read for the first time this afternoon. Caleb picked up a couple. Second down and 8. Clock moves under 6 minutes in the Virginia Tech spring game. Motley will hand it off to Caleb, and there's some running room inside the 40 before he spilled at the 36-yard line. That's a 12-yard pickup and a first down for the white team. All the scoring in this game was done in the first quarter.
Nice run by Caleb right there. He's having a great game today, and fans should be excited. You know, he came out of high school as a very highly touted recruit. They moved him from receiver to the running back position. Struggled a bit with his blocking. That's why he was buried on the depth chart. But right now, he's looking very comfortable at the running back position.
Seth Dooley a little bit slow to get up on the last play. The white team back to the line. From the 36, not much on the ground that time for Caleb. He tried the left side of that offensive line again, and he was stopped cold by Desmond Fry and Sean Heiselkamp.
This is the time of the game where you just want to finish strong and you don't want anybody to get any serious injuries. You're still evaluating, but you just want to finish with 5 minutes left and make sure everybody stays healthy and, you know, just make sure you come away with no significant injuries.
And now a whistle and a timeout on the field. The white team facing second down and 10 with 5:01 to go. Heiselkamp, we called his name a lot. 7 tackles here in the spring game. He's making a name for himself.
And that's what you do. I mean, listen, fans have a different perspective, but the coaches are looking at tape. They're looking at who's making plays, who's doing their assignments, and that's how you move up the depth chart. It's not about just touchdowns and great blocks. It's about knowing your assignments, because in a few months, the season will be upon us, and they're going to play the guys they trust. So 7 tackles says a lot.
Deion Clark and Damon McKinnon were a couple of guys who've been battling for one of those open linebacking spots. Bud Foster said he would give the edge to Clark coming in. McKinnon has made a couple of nice plays here today as well. You don't take anything in a vacuum. Everything is sort of weighed together. But Heiselkamp again accounting for himself well, and then McKinnon and Clark. This battle will go right on into August. Clark with 6 tackles here this afternoon. Very quietly so, I believe.
Very quietly. But you know what? The good news is if you didn't play as well as you thought, you still have August. And that's what they're going to look at. You know, they're going to look at this tape. They're going to evaluate who was flying to the football, who knew what they were supposed to be. But come August, it starts back all over again. Right now, after this game, we get to finish the season with your exams, making sure you're preparing for the fall semester, off-season workouts, and then come August, we're right back at it. So it's going to be another battle at the linebacker position. Clark is a great athlete, like his confidence, but there's still some positions that have to be earned.
Laird Gardner has checked into the game for the Maroon team as a defensive end, and stepping up is Motley, and he is going to be hit at the 40-yard line. It's going to be a loss of 4. It's Gardner that actually came in and made the hit. And that'll bring up 3rd down and about 14 to go here for the white team. Pressure coming from the edge. Guys like Nicholas Sinicanum. That time it was Laird Gardner off the edge. Third down and 15 as we approach 4 minutes to play. Motley with 2 receivers, or rather 3 to the right. He looks there and then takes off up the middle, looking for a little daylight. He'll be ushered out of bounds well short of the first down.
Interesting, a quarterback draw when the quarterback's not live, but you never know.
Darian Green, Desmond Fry were there to make sure that he stepped out. 8 yards shy of the first down. And with the ball at the 34, the wind blowing across the field, it would be a 51-yard field goal attempt. But the mantra of the day has been fourth down, so what? We'll go for it.
I think right now you look for the tight end. I think, but yeah, Bucky's in there. I think right now, if I'm the quarterback, I'm looking to see where Bucky lines up and maybe see if he can get open down the middle.
They need the 26-yard line. Motley looking right, gets pressured, and he'll be sacked in the backfield. Two sacks from inside the 40-yard line. Jeremy Haynes was the man in the backfield. He gets credit for the sack. And it's a turnover on downs. The Maroon team will get it back with 3:25 to go in the game. High drama in Blacksburg, trailing 7-3. The Maroon team, maybe one last possession in the game.
Well, you know what? Believe it or not, this is a great time for the coaches to see how they respond to adversity. This is a teaching tool. Coach Charles, the offensive line coach, is going to see how his offensive line handle a known passing situation. How do they handle D linemen coming off the edge?
Jerome Wright is the tailback. Leal to throw on first down, looking for long yardage on the right side, and it's off the hands of Carlos Parker. You mentioned Stacy Searles, the new offensive line coach here at Virginia Tech, comes over from Texas. Spent time at a couple of different stops in the SEC. He was an All-American offensive lineman in the late 80s under Pat Dye at Auburn. So he brings the old school, the lunch pail mentality to the offensive line.
Yeah, and I like his attitude. Nasty coach, but in a good way. He wants his old lineman to be physical. One of the things he said, I don't want to misquote him, but I heard him in the practice say, "We don't block linebackers, we run through them." And that's what you got to have. I like him. I love what he brings to this offensive line. And I think he's going to be a good coach for the offense.
Jerome Wright on the receiving end of that pass from Leal. It's a 6-yard gain. And the offense in hurry-up mode here, needing 4 yards for a first down. Leal is caught up in traffic in the backfield, and now it's the defensive line of the white team who forces the loss. It's a loss of 4 all the way back to the 45-yard line. And now the Maroon team will take a timeout with 2:48 to go, facing 4th down and 8.
What do we know? Another 4th down. Let's see what they draw up. I think it's critical that if you're an offensive line right now, you really want to make sure you protect well, even though the quarterbacks aren't live.
We've talked about defensive backs as well on this team and the history of defensive backs in the NFL. We'll see a couple of more this year, next month in the draft, perhaps two in the first round or the first or second round. And again, two gone, time to usher in two more. And but the history's there.
And it is there. And you know, that history, we could go back to 95 and 97 with guys like Torian Gray, who's a DB coach here, and Antonio Banks and Anthony Midget and Ike Charlton and Lauren Johnson. This has always been a place where if you want to find great DBs, you come here. And if you want to play for the best DB coach in the country, you come here in Torian Gray. Really love what they do. They are very aggressive. Some say we gamble on defense when it comes to our DB play, but it's just more so a swagger and confidence they play with every time they match up against another offense.
4th down and 8 to go. Two receivers left, two to the right. Leal floats it over to the right side. It's going to be batted away and incomplete. And the white team holds with 2:40 to go in the contest. Dietrich Bonner, there he is again, creating havoc in that defensive backfield in the secondary, and he forces the turnover on downs.
Torian Gray trusts him, and Torian Gray is one of the most difficult but yet enjoyable coaches to play for because he challenges his players to make plays, especially in man situations. And Bonner knows what he's supposed to do as a DB, and that speaks volumes about Torian Gray's confidence in him as a player.
So with 2:40 to go, the white team is back on the field. In the opening drive of the game, the white team went 87 yards in five plays thus far, resulting in the only touchdown of the game. Each team has had one drive of 50 yards or more since that opening possession. So some running lanes early. Of course, Dimitri Knowles raced down the left sideline, 52 yards. That was a big part of that 87-yard drive. And since then, the defense has hunkered down and been able to keep the offense in check for the most part this afternoon.
Well, it's Bud Foster, and he has a great defensive scheme, but it's also the spring. I mean, in fairness to the offense, there's not a lot of game planning. You're not seeing a lot of trick plays or hurry-up offense, what they do run. It's pretty vanilla, but that just shows you, even despite that, Bud Foster, again, great play by the defense right there. They know what to do once they've seen something a few times early in the game.
Talk about a hard-nosed guy. That's Mangus, and he has taken some punishment today. Sean Heiselkamp greeted him in the backfield, and that is his eighth tackle of the afternoon.
I tell you what, he's making a name for himself.
They'll give him forward progress to the 48. A loss of three, second down and 13 as we approach 2 minutes to play. Mangus, who sprained his left knee during spring 2 years ago, 25 carries, 141 yards and a score last season, also hauled in 9 catches for 72 yards, gets the carry and is caught up in the backfield again here. Sean Heiselkamp again on the stop.
Corey Marshall also over there. He's just having a great spring. Really happy for him to come back and join the team, making plays. He's a senior. I know he misses football, and it was great for him to get back, and he's showing why the coaches love him so much. He's having a great spring.
So three of the five quarterbacks on display here today. We mentioned earlier two more will be on campus by August. And we'll ask in just a moment how you'd evaluate all three today as Ford unloads the right side. The ball is batted into the air and then bounces out of bounds on that right sideline. It'll bring up third down and 17, or rather fourth down for the white team. The maroon team will get it back with a minute to go in the contest.
Well, you look at Ford, it's obvious that he has great potential, but it's potential that's probably going to need a red shirt this season. And then you look at Leal, really love the way he throws the football, but as a redshirt senior, they really want a little bit more of him. I thought he played well in spots today. Motley, a guy that's very athletic, he also played well in spots today. I thought he threw a great deep ball. The thing I think right now that gives him the slight edge is his mobility and the fact that he rarely turns the ball over. Now, again, it's spring, so there's a lot of time between now and September. So the quarterback position, it's still a question mark, but I think they start to have a better feel for who they want to start maybe come August.
Byrne makes the fair catch at the 10-yard line, and the maroon team will have one last chance here this afternoon after the 42-yard kick. 90 yards away from the end zone with 55 seconds to go, and Mark Leal trots back onto the field. All in all, a beautiful day to tailgate. Watch a little spring football. You take a look at the 2014 schedule. The home game to start the year, two of the first three outside the league at home. The Hokies open with four of the first five games here at Lane Stadium.
That'll be good for a young team to get some confidence. And, you know, Lane Stadium is still a tough place to play, so that schedule does set up nicely for them.
Leal over the middle, juggled, and then dropped inside the 20-yard line. And he was looking for Parker.
In this particular situation, we mentioned, again, Leal being a redshirt senior. He was actually in a similar situation in the Sun Bowl against UCLA. And even though it's the spring and he's with receivers he may not have played with, they want to see how he handles this. How does he handle the pressure off the edge, even though he's not live? Scott Leffler really wants to see if he makes the right decision. He's evaluating him on his decision-making and his poise in a two-minute drill.
You saw on the replay, Parker got his hands on the ball. It was thrown just a touch behind him. And it's second down and 10 with 51 seconds to play. Blitz look from the linebacker. And a short completion inside the 20 for Charlie Meyer. give him 8 on the play, and they'll try to hurry it up with under 40 seconds to go in the game.
Be interesting if they go deep here. They don't have much time.
Third down, long 1, short 2. With under 30 to play. The pass across the right side is picked off. The second interception of the day. This Ken Ikanem with pressure. Donovan Riley was there to pluck it out of the air. So Riley reaches up and snags it down. The second interception of the day thrown by Virginia Tech quarterbacks. One now for Motley and one from Leal. And Riley, with great extension, plucked it out of the air, and with 16 seconds to go in the game, that will preserve the victory for the white team.
Well, the good news is Virginia Tech wins. Mm-hmm. But again, going back to the quarterback battle, that is a turnover. Again, you know, Riley's a great DB, but that's a turnover that you just don't want. Even though it's the spring, that's what I was referring to earlier. You just can't throw that ball, and if you do, you have to either make it that the receiver's the only guy that can catch it or it goes out of bounds. And that's just a tough mistake by Leal.
So all in all, a couple of big plays from receivers in the running game. An early touchdown for Joel Caleb up the middle. And otherwise, another impressive effort. If the defense is generally ahead of the offenses during spring football, that was on display here today. And the Virginia Tech spring football game comes to a close. All 10 points of this one scored in the first quarter of play, in the white team hangs on to defeat the maroon team 7-3.
Great game. I mean, it's a spring. You can take some things away from it. Really like what you see with the young talent, with guys like Deion Newsom, Bucky Hodges, Marshawn Williams. You have some great receivers in Willie Byrne. But again, it's only the spring. A lot that the coaches have to work on moving forward towards the fall season.
And a number of significant players on both sides of the ball held out for injuries. They'll be added to the mix when fall rolls around. 7-3, the white team defeats the maroon team today. We'll come back to Lane Stadium with some final thoughts on the Virginia Tech spring game right after this.